Tonight on Axis TV, straight from New York City, it's Gotham Comedy Live. Get ready to laugh with Dan LaMorte, Robin Montague, Casey Arora, James Goff, and this week's host, Frank Caliendo.
Welcome to Gotham Comedy Live. We're going to have a great time tonight. You ready for this? Let's start out this way. I've been really enjoying over the past year this reality show. It's my favorite new reality show, the presidential election. I don't know what it is. It's ever since the beginning of the debates, watching Donald Trump has been the most amazing. Do we have Trump people here? Anybody? Okay. Anybody? Some Hillary people here tonight? Is that? People who like Donald Trump but didn't want to admit it, some of that. I've always loved watching Donald Trump, and it's just the thing. He's got those tremendous, it's amazing, it's incredible, it's the most luxurious thing I've ever seen in my entire life. Right now, I don't even have to open up my eyes. I know how great it is. I've actually tattooed myself on the inside of my eyelids, and I'm looking at myself. It's the number one thing. Everything's number one. It's the number one. It doesn't get any better than this. We're going to make America great again, and then we're going to make the planet great again, and then we're going to make the solar system great again, the galaxy great again, and then we're going to make the universe great again. And we're not going to stop there. We're going to make every universe great again. The Marvel universe, the DC universe. That's right, Spider-Man, Batman, and I will be fighting crime, throwing batarangs, spinning webs, and combing our hair in a circle. It'll be tremendous. It'll be the number one thing. And he's got this way, he's always been able to make up facts. I've never seen anyone who could do that. And the way he does it is this. After he says something, he'll say, and everybody knows it. Right, where does that come? It's brilliant. I don't care where you're on the political spectrum. It doesn't matter to me. None of that matters to me. I don't care. It's not like watching Jon Stewart or Bill Maher. None of that kind of stuff, okay? But if you watch him do that, he will come up with something and he'll make people believe it, okay? He'll be like, there's a colony of people on Mars. And 100% of them voted for me. It's true. 100% of the people on Mars voted for me, and everybody knows it. And then you go out in the street, people are like, do you hear about the colony on Mars? Yeah, 100% of them voted for Trump. I know. How'd you know? Because everybody knows it. And I'm not the only one saying this. And he's friends with everybody, right? I spent time with Papa John's. Papa John and I are friends. We spent a lot of time playing High Lie together. It was a tremendous time. I don't know how he's done it. And that's the thing is, like, think about that. And people will come to me all the time with, they'll be like, presidents having reality shows. Do you think that's ever going to happen? And like, George W. Bush with a reality show. Do you want to see that? And like, not really. when you're a president, you have to know what's going on in the world, right? You have advisors. You have to know everything. When you're a former president, they'll ask you questions like, what have you been doing since you've been president? And then those should be softballs, right? They should be simple. But with George W. Bush, they'll be like, what have you been doing since you've been president? Well,
I'm not really sure. I've been working on my Facebook page. I've been playing Pokemon Go.
It was the painting that I never expected, right? He did the paint. Have you seen some of the paintings he's done? I'd never expected in a million years. And when they ask him about that, what have you been painting?
Pictures. What kind of pictures? Pictures of stuff. What kind of stuff? Stuff that I've Googlified.
I don't want to see a reality show from George W. Bush. I want to see a painting show, okay? Just on PBS or something like that, an easel behind him. That's it.
I'm going to paint a happy little tree right here. I'm not even going to turn around. I just know what it looks like in my brain. Got some green things. Those are the leaves. Got some orange things coming down. Those are? Those are carrots. You know why? That's a carrot tree. They say money doesn't grow on trees, but in my world, carrots do.
They'll be the number one carrot tree we've ever seen. And everybody knows it.
Right there. Right there. Right there. No, see, that was a moment. That happens from time to time. I'll go too fast, and you'll need Morgan Freeman to help you out.
This is the time where nobody knew what Frank Caliendo was talking about. Sometimes he'd walk like one of those penguins across the Arctic or the Antarctic. I'm not really sure.
And he's the number one narrator of all time. We actually played tiddlywinks together. I don't even know what tiddlywinks is.
I have no idea where we're going with some of this stuff.
For me, it's fun to watch people. And sometimes you get known. You watch an actor, and they get known for a particular style. Like I watch Jeff Goldblum, right? Jeff Goldblum, you know him from Jurassic Park, Independence Day, the apartment.com commercials. But Jeff Goldblum will do that thing where he commits to something 100% and then does a complete 180. I know what you're thinking, that's a lot of math, but follow me on this.
Like, right about now, the audience trying to catch up.
He'll commit to something, and you think he can't change his mind. He does, like, what's your favorite food, Jeff?
Ah, good question. My favorite food. What is it? I like hot dogs. I do. They're very good. I like hot dogs, mustard, ketchup, all sorts kinds of things. Chili dogs are good. Cheesy dogs are better. Wait a second. I'm a vegetarian.
That's good. I like people who work with animals.
I'll go Charles Barkley on that.
That was just terrible right there.
So you watch these people.
Once again, the audience not sure where Frank was going with some of this stuff.
It's okay, you'll get there, you will. Wait a second, no you won't.
I like watching people like Robert Downey Jr. Since the Avengers and Iron Man, he's become Tony Stark all the time. Have you know? He doesn't come out of that character anymore, right? Like, he'll talk in little phrases and everything's about himself. He's a human Twitter feed, okay? 140 characters or less, everything's about himself. He could be giving out an Academy Award, which is supposed to be about the nominees, but he'd bring it back to himself like, these people deserve your applause almost as much as I do. Hashtag awesome. But that's it. We start to see actors in certain ways sometimes. Take Liam Neeson, for example, all right? All these years, he's been this great dramatic actor. He does the Taken movies, and suddenly, he's this badass action star. And it's all because of that phone call. In that, right? It's just the phone call. Could you imagine being a telemarketer calling Liam Neeson's house? You're never calling back. You're putting yourself on the do not call list at that point. You're making your friends call him, like, Mr. Neeson,
I don't know who you are. I don't know what you want. If you're looking for me to take a short survey, I can tell you this, I don't have the time. What I do have are a very particular set of skills. Skills that make me a nightmare for people like you. And if you don't hang up right now, I will find you. I will hunt you down. And that's when the caller realized they should have called Morgan Freeman's house.
That would have been the number one choice to go with right there.
That's another thing that Trump does, and I'll come back to it. Listen, it got a little bit of a lull in the show, and I'm going to make the show great again. It'll happen right here. But he'll find people to target and be like, China is taking over everything. Have you seen this? They're taking over our dishes. When your boss comes over, what do you get out? You get out your good China. I'm going to make that America again. It's going to happen. We're going to eat America. It's going to be tremendous. It'll be the number one. Right there, you're not even sure what to think about. Like, I'm not even sure where we're going with this. So you think about some of these people, like I was saying, where you know about the way they're taken or seen. And for me, it's always been John Madden. Because of the John Madden impression, people know me. Yeah, at least three people. Look, there's a couple ladies like, who's John Madden? Oh, the guy with the shoes? That'll be awesome.
You're the number one audience member. Listen, I want you to understand something. He's doing a tremendous job right now, he really is. And if you don't start laughing like him, I'm going to build a wall between you and the rest, and I'm going to make this part of the audience pay for you. It's going to be incredible, it really will.
Right about now, the audience realizing Frank didn't prepare much for this show at all.
I've always loved John Madden. Mostly because he's made me feel smart.
Made me feel like a rocket surgeon.
He'd say things like,
If the quarterback, if he throws the ball in the receiver, if he catches it in the end zone, then that's gonna be a touchdown.
Even my mom, who's never watched football, is like, no duh. John Madden loved one football player more than any other human being has ever loved another human being in the history of human beings. If in fact that human being is just a human being, and that human being Brett Favre. And I don't know what it is, maybe because
Favre.
The only thing that's see, very specific group right there. I went that there, like guys like, holy crap, where am I? Sometimes there's a playing
bring that studio game for just 2 seconds and help me raise their children?
Did you say something, honey? I didn't hear you. You told me to do something with my life. I'm in career mode, trying to build a dynasty.
Do you know how much money he's making from that? With just using his name on the licensing? He's not even in the game anymore. If I were John Madden, I'd put my name on every video game possible. You imagine playing Super Mario Brothers, the Madden edition? You wouldn't have to know you're playing it. Just jump Mario up, Mad's face pops on screen.
Boom, Mario just ate a mushroom. He did. He's 2 times bigger than he was a couple seconds ago. I mean, he was little Mario, and then after the mushroom incident, he became bigger Mario. I mean, that mushroom is a game changer. I mean, it really. Because when you're little Mario, all you can do is bounce off the bricks. I don't know why that is. Maybe because your little Mario hand can't get above your little Mario head, because your little Mario arm can't extend far enough, you end up hitting the bricks with your head, and maybe that soft spot from when you were a baby is still there. I mean, I don't know. I don't have access to Mario's medical records, but then when you're bigger Mario, you can break through the bricks. I mean that's one of those kinds of things that changes everything right there. You can get the flower, you start shooting fireballs, you got to bounce them, which doesn't make a lot of sense. But I mean that's just kind of, you ever get the flower? The star. You ever get the star? You get the star, you're pretty much the Brett Favre of Mario world. I mean, there's no, and a lot of things don't make sense in Mario world, like those bricks. How are they even there? Because there's nothing holding them up. They're just kind of bricks. I mean, maybe that's why there's so many question marks. People are wondering why the bricks are there. I mean, a lot of things don't make sense in Mario world. This is also a place where if you jump on a turtle, he goes into his shell. You jump on him again, he spins around, he knocks the other turtle. Bloop, bloop, bloop. I don't know where they go. But I mean, and take it from me, you jump on a turtle in the real world, none of that stuff happens. You just end up with a flatter turtle or maybe some turtle soup. And if I could get serious here as I wrap it up here, the whole story of Mario is a pretty amazing story when you think about it. Back in, I think, maybe 1982 it was, could have been 1983, I'm not exactly sure, but Mario was just a little Italian immigrant. And he came to this country from Japan. With his brother Luigi. And they were just trying to build their business, and everything was going their way. They had everything they'd ever wanted to do. And it was the American dream for Mario and Luigi, and that's when things got tough. Because Mario's girlfriend got kidnapped by a gorilla.
Right about now, the audience, yes, taking this a little too seriously and not realizing this is just Donkey Kong.
You guys ready for a great show coming up, huh? We've got some incredible comedians coming on right after this. Stick around, everybody.
Live from the Gotham Comedy Club in New York City, Dan LaMorte is taking the stage when we return. And stick around later for more with Frank Caliendo when he returns to the stage. Welcome back to Gotham Comedy Live. More great stand-up coming your way starting right now.
We're going to keep it moving right along. You guys ready for your next comic? You've seen him on Fox's Red Eye. Please welcome Dan LaMorte.
Oh, I was on Facebook this morning and I saw a girl post, "Oh my God, just cut off 4 inches of hair. That's so long." So I sent her a message. I was like, "Hey, love the way you describe 4 inches." I think we should hang out sometime. You'd be pleasantly surprised. I could probably give you five. That's so true. Everyone in the front row looked at my crotch and they're like, yeah, that joke is for real. They're like, he's not lying. Who watched the Olympics this past summer? I was watching the powerlifting portion of the Olympics, and this happened verbatim. The announcer turns to his co-announcer. He goes, hey, Joe, did you know the average kindergartner weighs 45 pounds, which means on each side of that bar, there's 8 kindergartners. Did you just nationally out yourself as a pedophile? That is not a statistic any grown man should know, yet be saying out loud. You know he got home from Rio and the FBI was just waiting at his front door like, dude, you know what you did. Also, pretty upset, where's he getting his information from? I know I weighed 85 in kindergarten. Not weighing the fat kids is a cheat. I've been sober for 2 months now, thank you. I learned in sobriety that your views of your friends are definitely hindered by the amount of alcohol in your system. For instance, we all have that group of friends that we go out with, and when you're all drunk, you're like, I would kill for these people. And when you're sober around those drunk friends, you're like, I would kill these people. You're like, there's no redeeming qualities about my friends at all. I'm definitely the good friend here. I should find better friends. In my sobriety, I lost 20 pounds. Don't clap, still fat. And I lost weight for a couple of reasons. The first one was I took a girl on a date to Six Flags Great Adventure, one of the biggest amusement parks in the country. We hit it off. It's going well. She looks at me, she goes, Dan, let's go on El Toro, one of the biggest wooden roller coasters in the country. We wait 75 minutes, get to the front, they strap you in with just the seatbelt and a lap bar, we're good to go. For those of you who don't know, every roller coaster has its own PA system. So we're waiting for the roller coaster to go, all of a sudden over the loud system I hear, seat 17 doesn't fit, seat 17 doesn't fit. Then that moment of panic sets in where you start counting very slowly. 1, 2, 17. I should have saw that coming. It's me. And you think Six Flags would just ask you to leave the ride, but it's not that simple. Six Flags has a team of minions that seemingly come out of nowhere, two of which straddle the side of you and start kicking down. Well, one gets on top and starts slamming down like he's giving CPR to his dying mother. I turn to her, I'm like, don't worry, it's okay. In my head, I'm freaking out. My testicle's currently in my asshole. I'm like, it's not okay, I'm never gonna have a child. Moral of the story, fellas, is if you think you're too fat to roller coaster, don't take a girl to Six Flags, because this scenario never happens. She never wakes up the next morning, calls her friend and goes, hey, Jen, it was a great date, we hit it off, he didn't fit in the roller coaster. And then I blew him. That's never how that ends. That story ends in fellatio 0 times. Well, in my newfound weight loss, I was looking for different gyms to go to and I stumbled upon a Planet Fitness. What a pathetic excuse for a gym. 2 days a week, they give free pizza and bagels. I'm fat, and never once have I been benching and thought, you know what would go good with this chest press? A slice of pepperoni. No, bring over the everything bagel with cream cheese. That's really gonna activate the abs. That's what I need. And what pisses me off is they say they're a judgment-free zone, which is true, but there's only one true way to lose weight. Judgment. Give you a scenario. I'm hanging out with my 4-year-old nephew. He has a new pair of glasses on. I say, hey, Braden, let me put them on. I put them on me. I say, how do I look? He goes, still fat. I was like, wow. I go, Grandma, did you just hear what Braden said to me? She goes, yeah, your arteries are clogged, not your ears. Whoa. Just got roasted by my 80-year-old born-again Christian grandmother. Thank you. I'm 21 years old. I know I look like I'm 30. Let's not talk about it. I feel like when God was making me, he said, give him the divorced father of three look. And this is what you get. Thank you. I've been arrested 3 times. Anyone else? Yeah. Last time I was arrested, I was 17 years old, wasn't doing well financially. So I was like, let me become a salesman of marijuana. Now, unfortunately, nothing about this look screams successful drug dealer. But anyway, me and 4 friends get in my car to go make the pickup. Mistake number 1, never be the driver in a drug deal, because when things go south, you need to go down with the ship because it's registered in your name. Mistake number 2, we make the pickup, 8 grams of marijuana. My buddy goes, Dan, where should I put it? When your friend asks that pivotal question, go, buddy, put it in the trunk. Not me. I said, buddy, put it in the center console right next to me. I want it to be safe. Mistake number 3, we drive away. I run a red light. In my defense, it was yellow. That's nor here nor there. And the officer comes up to my window. He goes, license and registration. I'm like, yeah, sure, officer. It's right here in the center. I don't have it. He goes, you're not even going to look. I'm like, nah, I'm good. Then he says the one thing you never want to hear. He goes, son, I'm gonna search the car. At this point, I'm 17 years old. The only legal advice I know comes from a man named Sean Carter, AKA Jay-Z. So I look at the cop and I'm like, well, my glove compartment is locked, so is the trunk in the back, and I know my rights, so you're gonna need a warrant for that. I ain't passed the bar, but I know a little bit, enough that you won't illegally search my shit. The moral of the story is don't take legal advice from Sean Carter, AKA Jay-Z. Because he did not need a warrant, and he searched the shit out of my car. Guys, I'm Dan LaMorte. Thank you so much.
Live from the Gotham Comedy Club in New York City, Robin Montague is taking the stage when we return. Stay tuned for more laughs on Access TV.
Ready for our next comic? Come on, let's hear it. She's been seen on The Tonight Show. Please welcome Robin Montague.
What's up, New York? So listen, school is already started. And already there's a rumor going around the elementary school near my house that one of the teachers has the Zika virus. Yeah, I know. It's like a real rumor, but like it kept going on, so I got nervous. I took the kids out of school. I don't have any kids. I just took kids out of school so they wouldn't get the new Zika virus. You see what I do at night? I got all morning to go to elementary schools, and that's what I did. I went to the school and said, give me them kids. I'm taking these kids out of school. And they gave them to me. So I had all these kids, you know, I called it rescuing. The police called it kidnapping. So they took me downtown with the principal. They're gonna make me talk to the school the precinct psychiatrist, and she's got all frustrated. She's like, I don't know why Robin even took the kids. She doesn't have any kids. She never raised any kids. It don't even seem like she likes kids. So then the principal said, well, that'll make her a good middle school teacher. I'm like, why? He goes, because, you know, the teenage boys won't be into you. I'm like, oh, wait a minute. You trying to say I can't turn on a teen? No, I got my feelings. I was offended. Wait a minute. The teenagers be hollering at me all the time. Young boys love, you hear me? I was mad. I was like, let me tell you something. You bring a 17-year-old here, I will dry hump a 17-year-old right here, right now in this precinct. Bring them in here. I will dry hump a couple of them. So I was in jail 2-3 days. It was cool because I don't have any kids. I don't have to take nobody nowhere. People don't know what to say about women like me. Been married a couple times, never had kids. They almost don't know how to explain it. Like, my father just gave up. Now he just tell everybody I'm gay. I'm like, Daddy, you know that's not true. He's like, I know, because if you were gay, you'd have some kids. To have kids in the city because our apartments are too small. Am I right, New Yorkers? Yeah. My apartment is too small. If I had a baby, the baby gonna have to live in a storage space down the street. I can't fit no baby in a bathroom. I can't share a bathroom with a baby. What? Baby weigh 10, 12 pounds. If I gain 10, 12 pounds, I can't fit in my own bathroom. I can't do it. And then my mother's all like, well, you could take the fertility drugs. Like, now all of a sudden I want to have 8 babies in one day. Young girls, don't take the fertility drugs. They're too strong. Don't do it. You shouldn't have more babies than a farm animal. It's too much. It's too much. Y'all remember that lady had them 8 babies, that white woman, I call her Octoroon, y'all know, y'all didn't want to claim her. White people, oh, I think she's Indian. No, she was white and crazy. That's what she was, white and crazy. 8 babies at the same time, one day. You can't love all them babies. You can't. It's too many. You can't love all them babies. I ain't had no baby, but babies, 10 infants, they look alike. Don't they look like they got the same baby look? They all look like the same. I'm saying, oh, she could be loving the same 3 over and over. I ain't having no 8 babies. I can't dress no 8 babies and take them to go to school. I just send them to school naked. Let the teachers work it out. I can't. I'm not doing it. It's too much. All I'm saying, if I'm at the mall and I realize I forgot 2, I'm just gonna keep driving. That's what I'm gonna do. I got 6 more in the back. Somebody will pick them up. People are nice at the mall. It's good I don't have kids. I'm too forgetful to have kids in the first place. Every Ash Wednesday, I'm always walking up to people. You got a little something on you? Let me wipe that off you. And I got a low threshold for pain. I can't even brush my teeth without crying. I just have to use whiteout. Fuck it, I just. A little sticky, but still. I like babies. I do. I do. In fact, I'm throwing a baby shower for one of my best girlfriends. She's having twins. Like, it's major. Like, she and her husband, it is great. Her husband and her, they're so excited. They're so happy. They're white, you know. No, I don't want to go black and white on you, but that's what I'm going to do when I tell you. Brothers don't tend to, they're not too keen on the multiple thing, you know what I mean? Seriously, if a sister get pregnant, I mean, if I, you know, I think I'd have to just, like, bring one home. Then, like, 9 months later, sneak the other little motherfucker in. Just be like, it was all a dream. mean, you know. Confuse him with some Biggie or some Patrick Duffy from Dallas. I just, you know, you have to do that. When you don't have kids, you don't care about things that you regular people care about. You know what I mean? Like the environment. Green is just a color to me. I don't understand it. No, it's not good. We don't care about the future because there is no future. You go to my apartment right now, the heat's on, the windows are up, and it's an aerosol hairspray just spinning around. People don't talk about women like I got the young boyfriend. He's cute, really cute. He loves me. Robin, you should have a baby. It's cute how he thinks I still can. Those are Tic Tacs, a little white pill he see me taking every day. I don't have him for the brain power, ladies. I'm gonna tell you that now. No, I don't have kids, but eventually, you know, I'll still won't ever have kids, is what I'm saying. I never will. And that'll be just the end of it, because kids are a blessing and a jewel for everybody except for me. Except for me. You guys have been amazing. Thank you so much.
Live from the Gotham Comedy Club in New York City, Casey Arora is taking the stage when we return. Stay tuned for more laughs on MADtv. Welcome back to Gotham Comedy Live. More great stand-up coming your way starting right now.
We are going to keep it moving. Our next comic, you may have seen him on season 2 of The Unmovers. Please welcome Casey Arora. All right. Tell you guys about me. I'm the child of immigrants. Nice. My parents came here to chase the American dream because they heard that in America, the streets are paved. That's it. They didn't. They're like, concrete's good enough. No. I feel like they achieved the American dream because my brother's a doctor and I'm, well, took a karate class recently. So, just one though, so it's not, you know. But I'm sitting there in this class, and some dude, he starts piping up, you know? He's like, yo, sensei, what if the dude's got a gun? I'm like, that's a good question. And he won't stop because the instructor's ignoring him. So he keeps getting angry. He's like, sensei, 9mm. To the dome, sensei. That's the head. What do you do? Finally, the instructor's like, well, you give him your wallet. I was like, fuck that. I just got up and left. I'm like, why take karate when I can go buy a gun? And then come back and rob a whole karate class. Down. I don't know. Certain things I feel like I'm just done with entirely. Like the bra. Done, ladies. I'm not doing it anymore. Take off your own damn bra. Hooks? Why are we using hooks? They're breasts. They're not rabid dogs. They don't need to be muzzled. And you get angry at us? You get angry. What, you don't think I want to see the titties? You know, shouldn't it just be Velcro at this point? Don't you get tired after a long day? Wouldn't you like to just come home and go, shh, and then air them out? I'm sitting here, I got my face jammed into your chest like I'm trying to fix a broken vending machine. I just want to get my snack, that's all I want. One time I was hooking up with this girl and, you know, I finally get her bra off and she's like, I want to take off your belt. I was like, yeah, go for it. Enjoy yourself, you know? And she's fumbling. She's like, I don't know how this works. I'm like, you also wear belts. And she's like, you do it. I was like, yeah, I undo it. And she's like, I'll take it from here. I'm like, what's left to take? And I'll never forget what happened, because she took the belt and she pulled the whole thing out like Indiana Jones all of a sudden. Like, give me a yeah, something. Choke me. Let me know I'm alive. She's just holding it like a snake she just rescued by the side of the road. And then she just set it on the ground, and we're both staring at it like it's supposed to slither away. And I'm like, I don't even live here. I got to put that back in the morning. And you ladies have been lied to the whole time. It's not that you take forever to get ready. It's just that men take it slower and lazier when we get undressed, because the belt stays in the pants, because these might just be tomorrow's pants. I don't know. It's only when you're single do you really realize what you look like. You know? Like, when you're in a relationship, there's always somebody going, oh, you're pretty. Oh, you're handsome. And you're like, yeah, you're right. I am. I am good looking. But when you're alone, you're like, oh, God. This is my face. And I've learned to live with it. I've learned to live with, like, these dark circles under my eyes, the smoky eye look. Jealous ladies, I wake up like that. Well, but it's difficult. It's tough to be single these days. It's not easy. Sure, you could talk to people online, but I remember a time when you could speak to people face to face. You know, you could just walk up to somebody and be like, excuse me, miss, and they'd be like, what the fuck do you want? I'd be like, all right, on to the next one. But now people have headphones in, they're plugged in, plugged out, staring at their phone, going, oh, why am I alone? Why can't I meet anybody? Look up, there are people everywhere. My friend, she's a single gal, she's like, I can't seem to meet anybody. I'm like, listen, you take a bus every morning, you take a train every morning, take off the headphones, talk to someone. She's like, well, if a guy wants to talk to me, he'll just come up and talk to me. I'm like, yeah, but we're not all drunk at 9 a.m. It's difficult to hit on women. Ever watch a guy hit on a girl and fail? You ever see that shit? It's like watching a grown man swim for the first time. And then drown. And not for nothing, but sometimes you women are like negligent lifeguards. You're like, where are all the good guys? Where are all the good men? Where are the good men? He's right there drowning. Go get him. But I get it. You go through a lot. You deal with a lot. I was on a packed train. I saw this dude get up, look at this woman, and go, hey, yo, ma. Your face is mad symmetrical. That's it. No follow-up, no nothing. Essentially, all he said was, hey, yo, ma. Half your face looks like the other half your face. It's like, that is crazy. I was like, I went up to her. I'm like, man, what did you think about that? She's like, I found it annoying. I found it irritating. I'm like, are you serious? Like, as a guy, it'd be nice if that happened to us from time to time. That'd be a good feeling, you know? Packed rush hour train. All of a sudden, this lady pops up. Hey, yo, papi. Your eyes are so smoky. You're like a raccoon. You're beautiful. I'm like, oh, my God. I think more women should hit on men. I do. I really do. I'm not saying we'll stop hitting on you at night, ladies, but how about you return the favor in the morning? You know? You want a strong economic plan for this country? I got one for you. Tell every guy that women will be hitting on them in the morning. Every guy will go to work. Even men without jobs will just be sitting on the train like, well, this shit's gotta happen. I just got a briefcase full of crackers. I'm not really going anywhere. Oh, man, could you imagine that world where women were hitting on men? Oh, it'd be amazing. Such an amazing place. Walk into the office, I'm like, Carl, you won't believe this. Some lady offered to buy me coffee. Huh. I told that chick, no thanks. I'm a single independent man. I buy my own coffee. Listen, that's my time. My name's Casey Roy. Thank you very much.
Live from the Gotham Comedy Club in New York City, James Goff is taking the stage when we return. Stay tuned for more laughs on Access TV.
Are you ready for our final comic? Come on, let's hear it. I just met him today, had a great time talking with him. You can enjoy his weekly podcast, Forced to Care. Please welcome to the stage, James Goff.
Hey, what's up, white people? How y'all doing? Woo, this is a lot of white people in here. I feel like I'm at an auction. Like, this is weird. Oh, yeah, if you didn't laugh at that, this is going to be a long set. Ooh, because that first joke is, ooh, it's tense. You ready? Here we go. So I used to want to be famous, right? And then I saw what happened to Cosby, and now, not so much. Yo, they took Cosby out. Like, it's over for black people. And I'll be honest, ladies, I was a supporter when it was three. When it was three, I was like, look at them, they trying to take the black man out. Then it was 10. I'm like, look at these gold diggers. They smell blood in the water. Then it was 50. I'm like, yo, this dude's the Tiger Woods of rapists. I can't defend this. I'm tapping out. I got to turn my black card in on Monday. And it messed me up because I grew up on The Cosby Show, you know? The Cosby Show was a black sitcom that took place on NBC. You look a little lost. Like, when I found out I was having a kid, right, I didn't take any of Lamar's classes or anything like that. I watched the first three seasons. I was like, if Cliff don't show it, I don't need to know it. That's how I felt. I watched the show now, and it's from a different outlook. I'm looking at the show now, and I'm like, Rudy, you better not drink that drink. If you knew what I knew, you wouldn't drink that drink. Where the hell is Claire at? Cliff is at it again. It's crazy, man, because when you think rapist, you don't think Bill Cosby. You think somebody menacing, like, ah, give me your titties, like somebody like that. You don't think of somebody with a sweater on that makes a face like, mwah. That's not the face of a rapist. Like, why do you have to do it? You're Bill Cosby. For the right price, you can get any woman you want. You're Bill Cosby. Then it dawned on me. Ladies, what if that's his sex face? Could you imagine every time your man came, he was like, mwah. How many times did he make that face and women laughed at him before he went, I gotta rape a bitch, this is getting out of control. I'm not condoning it, I'm just saying there's an option. Had something weird happen to me a week ago. This random kid walked up to me, he was like, hey mister, do you wanna live till you're 90? And I looked that little kid in the face. I was like, hell no. 90? At that age, you could die from anything like sadness. That means one Disney movie could take you out. And I'm scared about getting old, man. Like, and I'm talking the kind of old where like your body is shaped like a question mark. You know what I'm talking about? Every time you talk, it look like moths are flying out of your mouth. Like, is there a draft in here? Is this place haunted? And their hand look like it's stuck in a permanent gang sign. You ever seen that? You're just staring at them like, Jesus, how long were you cripping for? Dude, it's time to get out the game, baby. You too old for this. You ever seen somebody that old? Is it, don't it always look like they're trying to give you something hazardous? Like, I don't want that butterscotch. They get mad too when you call them old. I'm not old. These are my best years. No, it's not. The only way I'm cool with getting old is if I can pick my grand exit, because it's going to take place in a naked pillow fight at Playboy Mansion. You feel me, sir? Like, just me, a bunch of playmates, I get knocked out with a silicone titty. Like, oh. Miss October, and then I fade to black. This stuff I think about. It's about to get weirder.
Brother Maud, Scott.
I got a lot of questions about the afterlife. You know? For instance, think there's homeless people in heaven? I know. I'll be pissed. Like, I gotta deal with that twice? And imagine how you feel if you're homeless. That means God liked you enough to let you into heaven, but not enough to give you a studio apartment? That's messed up. Now I'm sitting on the curb of a cloud just trying to figure this whole afterlife thing out. Like, how many Hail Marys did I need to get that studio? And I'm like most people, when you think heaven, what do you think? You think a better version than your living life, which leads me to believe that Hugh Hefner is immortal. I think he died already, and God was like, I can't do better than this. Like, what do you think when you think heaven? All white everything, fluffy clouds, clean, golden arms. But what if it's like that? Because God has OCD. And the minute you get up there, he's like, don't touch that. Stand up, float in the air. Damn! Dude, I came up here to relax. And why is there plastic slip covers on the clouds? Like, come on, G-O-D. What if it's boring? Because anytime I had fun, it was always with somebody I knew was going to hell. Like, what if we're all in heaven, right, trying to sneak out because it's a hot party in hell? Like, yo, is God asleep? Yo, make sure his eyes is closed. All right, let's go. All right, now check this out. When we get down, oh, snap, who told Jesus? Everybody turn around. Nah, G, we're just gonna make fun of him at the gate like, you can't come in. But what if there's nothing? No heaven, no hell, we just floating in space, phasing through rocks like, ooh, that tickles. You mean to tell me I did the right thing for no reason? I took care of my kids for no reason? You know what stuff I missed out on? You know how bad I want to try crack just to see if I can quit? Because I'm competitive, and I ain't like how my third grade teacher explained it. Because she was looking at me like, if you do drugs, then you're going to get addicted. And she just kept looking at me. There's 30-something kids in this class. Why am I the crackhead? He's sniffing glue and eating boogers. Why the hell am I the crackhead? That's been on my time. I appreciate y'all.
Live from the Gotham Comedy Club in New York City, Frank Caliendo is taking the stage when we return. Stay tuned for more laughs on Access TV.
You guys have a good time? Let's bring up all the comics. Come on. Dan LaMorte.